bonfire night and we need money to buy fireworks, like cheap fireworks, like tomorrow.
No. Yeah. What we need to do is we need to get money to buy loads and loads and loads of toilet roll, which we'll scrunch up into little triangular toilet roll things and push into the ears of startled animals.
Oh, yeah.
That's very, very...
My girlfriend's
very
told me that she's read two news articles of puppies having heart attacks.
Puppies?
The last few days.
Humanity.
I know, exactly.
Well, give us some money, we'll save all the puppies. I think that's fair, right?
Yeah, easiest way to...
Imagine having a heart attack.
Easiest way to give us money is to sign up to our Patreon.
Yep. How can puppies get any more excited?
It's patreon.com/unsungpod. Donate to our puppy fund.
And you get stuff in return?
That is... I feel like we're exploiting the deaths of puppies.
We're not. We're saving puppies.
We're not really going to use that money to save puppies. That is...
If that's what the public decide...
I'm taking a stand here, right? If we get...
I'll buy one roll of toilet roll.
You honestly go around putting it into the ears of puppies with heart murmurs?
Any puppy I can find.
I think this is false advertising, and I think what we're doing under the guise of comedy is actually profoundly unethical.
I mean, is this different from any other week? so go to patreon.com/unsungpod. Check out the rewards and stuff like that. That'd be really good. And then you can see if you want to donate. You obviously do want to donate though, right? You don't not want to.
Yeah, you definitely do. It's worth it.
Especially if
it's the right thing to do. Think of the puppies.
What's a bargain?
We got like £1,000 lying around. Like, definitely just chuck it out.
And if you don't do it, then I'm going to spend the next week running about startling puppies.
I thought you were going to say just go running around kicking puppies.
No,
randomly kicking puppies.
I was trying to keep it funny.
That is funny, it's just dark.
No, well, I mean, there's a comedic line between
startling
the image of me
kicking.
Running about trying to sneak up on puppies and frighten them, or tell them things about the impending financial collapse, as opposed to me just kicking cute little animals. That's
the impending financial collapse.
I think we've probably fucked this episode already.
Fuck it, who cares? It's your birthday, Chris.
It's my birthday.
Right.
We could ask for money last week and put it towards my birthday.
I know, but we didn't.
No.
Didn't do that.
And so fucking do nothing. Like, one of my mates is buying me a pizza and then I'm coming home to watch The Walking Dead.
Excellent, that sounds exciting.
So just a couple of shout outs here. Apparently we've got 9 due. I think I've done some of these, but we'll do it again because I didn't mark them as complete. No, we've definitely done some of these because I have definitely said these out.
That's cool, they get a bonus.
Tim Russell, I know I've said your name before. Jason, definitely said your name before. And I fucked up your surname, so I'm not going to say it again. Blair Charbonneau.
Charbon?
Yeah, Charbon.
Yeah. I mean, that's like a French place.
Mark Adam, Kenny Bonella. And new guy who just joined us today, Sammy Edwards.
Thanks, Sammy.
And if we forgot your name, please let us know.
Thank you. You'll all have treats coming to you soon.
Yeah, enjoy your benefits, which the people who are listening to this probably don't have, and they should go to unsungpod.net/donate and do that.
Donate.
Great. All right.
Onwards
thanks
with the
Let's
podcast.
Get on with this.
Hi, welcome to the Unsung Podcast. I'm your host, Mark Fraser.
He's your host, Mark Fraser.
And he is your host, Mark Fraser.
Yeah.
Oh, you remember we used to actually
introduce each other.
Yeah.
Well,
I wonder if we can pinpoint what episode that actually
when it collapsed.
Somebody can.
Well, sitting across from me is the birthday boy, Mr. Chris Cusack.
Yeah, it's
happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Chris.
It is I.
Are you 40 yet?
You're like 45.
I'm not 40.
Oh, man.
No. But I am.
Closer to 40
working
than
on my
30.
Dad bod. I'm working on trying to expand that area below the moobs, but above the kind of like paunch.
Yeah, what would you call that?
It's like it's where your stomach actually is. You know, it's where the food lands.
Yeah.
And you get that kind of weird phase in a male life where if you're not a gym bunny, it just starts to protrude just too much.
Just because?
It's just there, and it's like you start.
I'm going to call that the Grinch. That's what it feels like. It feels like a Grinch.
Well, it's going to destroy Christmas. I'm working on that, trying to force that steadily outwards.
Have you had I see some people on the internet pretty much stretch their birthday out to a whole week. And they're like, oh, this is my birthday weekend. And this is, it's still my birthday. Have you had a nice birthday week?
Crispalast.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. I had a good weekend. I went to a couple of shows. I saw Big Business on Sunday night.
Yeah, how was
who
that?
Who were momentously good. Like, just absolutely furious and brilliant. That was a really well-spent night. I saw some other music, saw a couple of movies, both of which I didn't expect much from. The new Terminator, the sequel of The Shining, which I didn't think was a thing that should be, and actually was surprised that both are pretty decent. Not great, but pretty decent. And yeah, had a nice time hanging out, made some new friends. So it was okay, and like a sad boy, B-O-I, I treated myself to a weekend away in Bologna, which is where I'm going on Friday. Treat. Yeah,
the home of bologna.
Is it?
Bologna, that's what they call bologna. They spell bologna, Bologna in America. Mm. Bologna and bologna are the same thing. Mm. In America.
Except when they say bologna.
It's bologna, like, sausage is bologna sausage.
Yeah, but when you're talking bologna, they spell it B-A-L-O-N-E-Y.
Yeah, but if you have a bologna sausage, it's actually bologna.
Yeah, I wonder why the other one changed. It's also not the home of spaghetti bolognese.
I had spaghetti bolognese
from
last night.
New York. It's the home of lasagna. So there you go.
Hey.
Well, there you go. Do you know, I'm perfecting a spaghetti bolognese that I would love to
foist upon.
Let an Italian try and see what they think.
Feed it to a puppy.
Yeah, to startle a puppy with. Spaghetti!
You'd be like, has it got meat in it? You'd be like, no. They'd be like,
I have a friend who only feeds his dog vegan dog food.
Dogs can't.
I don't think that's right at all.
I don't think it is either, but he does.
Dogs can handle a non-meat diet, but cats cannot.
Yeah, but they're not consenting to it.
No, they're not consenting to it.
No.
But if you go down that route, then should humans have pets?
Yeah, no. It's a slippery slope.
Exactly, it's a very slippery slope. So.
No.
Mark.
Yeah, hi.
How are you? How's your week been?
It's been okay. I was trying to think there what I've been doing for the past week, and I can't fucking think of anything. I hosted a lip sync battle on Working Friday, and I wore a spectacular
set. How did that go?
How did your DJing go?
It was great fun.
Did you see a picture, David?
Oh yeah, he looked sharp as hell.
Yeah.
I'm going to wear it at our club night.
Jeez, oh.
And it's going to be glorious. It is the cheapest suit I've ever bought, and I'm fairly certain that if an open flame was near me, I would definitely go on fire. But it was also the best fitting suit I've ever had, despite the fact I've had many tailor suits. It was still the best fucking fitting suit I've ever had.
Working on your dad bod.
I don't know what that's all about. It was made of stars. That's all I can really say.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was fun. I spray painted my hair silver. That was cool.
Great.
A wee insight into the future there.
I didn't actually know that you'd done that.
Yeah. My beard and my hair.
Oh, wow.
And then I got home at like 2:30 and I was like, I'm going right in the fucking shower to get this shit off, and it worked. So.
Yeah, fair play. On Saturday night, I went to see a hip hop act called Injury Reserve. They were playing in I know you can't get very sold out because it's either sold out or not, but Mono on Saturday night felt very, very sold out. It was so sweaty. Basically, you know how you sell 300 tickets and 260 folk might turn up. Felt like all 300 people turned up and they were all right at the front and there's, you know, no security. And the band they just turn on the smoke machine and the only lights they have are big, huge strobe lights facing the crowd.
Mm.
And it was quite a sensory overload, but it was good. Yeah, it was like one of those shows where a lot of young people were very excited to be there. And that was interesting.
I like how we now talk about that from the perspective of people that don't fit in that category.
Yeah, exactly. I definitely don't fit in that category.
It's
anymore,
just there so. In the tone.
But I was a young person excited by the album we're going to talk about, Mark.
As was I.
Yeah.
I was thinking about it when I was doing the research, and I think this might actually be the first hardcore record I ever bought.
Oh, really?
I wasn't that young.
Yeah.
And I wasn't that excited. So, let's crack on.
Let's get your... So what are we talking about?
We're talking about Pass the Flask by the Bled.
Yep.
Which... yes, seriously took me back.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where to start. Where should I start?
Probably the start.
Maybe at the start.
I can't even remember how I heard this band, like, to be honest. The previous hardcore record that I had heard properly before this one was American Nightmare's Background Music. And the reason I heard that was because I seen a review of it in Kerrang. It got 5Ks.
Uh-huh.
And that was super abrasive, unlike anything I'd ever really heard before. At the time, I was kind of getting into like metalcore and stuff like that, so I think I probably picked up this band through one of the bands, maybe support one of the bands I went to see at the time.
Mm-hmm. They were on some fairly sizable tours.
Yeah, especially
after this record, though.
I remember I've seen these guys a whole bunch of times. I definitely seen them supporting somebody in King Tut's, but I seen them playing downstairs in the Barfly, and it was sold out, and it was like just like fucking 60 minutes of utter chaos.
Yeah, I remember the first time I heard of the Bled was in Kerrang as well, and they were getting like 5k live reviews, and they were chaotic, and they had black curly hair, so they were obviously getting compared to At the Drive-In and to Trail of Dead, but they were breaking instruments, and they had this like sort of total air of chaos around the time that this album was coming out. So I was like, immediately went and bought the record.
But that's totally misleading.
Yeah, kind of.
Completely.
Well, I would say
musically. Oh my god, they're miles apart.
Yeah.
I would say that. But I mean, in terms of the chaotic energy on stage,
audience-wise, they're miles apart as well.
Yeah, maybe.
This is a little guy band. I mean, there's one thing you can say about Trail of Dead, for example, that kind of Sonic Youth aesthetic was much more gender neutral. I think the Bled are the epitome of, or at least at this point, a little guy band. A little guy, black shirt, fringe, getting in the pit, kind of little guy.
You're talking exactly about my ex-flatmate, whose MySpace name was named after the Bled song. So, yes, correct.
Mm-hmm. So they kind of came around about the same time and from the same kind of vibe as Every Time I Die.
This album is 2003, but they already had two EPs prior to that, a self-titled one and... Mm-hmm. What was the other one called?
The other one was called...
Something First Crash.
His First Crush.
Crush.
Yeah. Which, first EP doesn't even have the same singer on it as the guy that's on this record tonight. It sounds completely different, like... Or definitely a band.
To interject here, right? So we should probably delineate here. This album came out in 2003 and, as we found out, went out of print for like about 5 years. And
yeah, the record label actually just went up in flames. Went out of business. So
basically they reissued it with the first two EPs tacked on. So the version, there's like a white version, which is a reissue, which is like 20 songs or something like that. Mm-hmm. And then there's the black version, which is what we're going to review, which is the original version of it.
Came out in 2003.
10 tracks. So to kind of make that clear. And if you want to hear those EPs, they are on that extended version that was re-released years later when the band had kind of kicked on.
Yeah. Chris is right in saying they're definitely a wee guy band, because they were touring at the time with bands like From Autumn to Ashes and Thursday and stuff like that, and they're heavier than pretty much most of the bands we're touring with, and a lot more technical as well in places, and they were wee guys when they released this record. Like, they were still really young guys. After they signed to Fiddler and released this album, they did their first ever tour outside Arizona, which is where they were from at the time, and it just kind of exploded from there, I guess. Yeah. For them, and they were just on the road forever after that. Feels like, anyway, up until they had their breakup hiatus thing, and then eventually broke up in 2011.
So, like, the band were originally called the Radiation Defiance Theory, which is about as close as you can get to the Dillinger Escape Plan.
Yeah, totally. you think like that band?
You think? Aye. I do.
It's very much like a Dillinger Escape Plan light, I would say. They take a lot of influence from like metalcore, more like Unearth kind of stuff, maybe even like Songs to Fan the Flames, Refused, that kind of
thing. There's a lot of Refused in here. Also on the second record as well, you can hear a lot of Refused.
It's like earlier Refused though, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I remember in the reviews that Kerrang had, they were like, it's metalcore but with a very Refused influence, and also an At The Drive-In influence, just in terms of like maybe the higher up guitar sort of melody bits and tapping and stuff like that. Even, I mean, but it is within that metalcore structure, and
it's completely apolitical, though.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's all about late teenage heartbreak and stuff like that.
Did the singer quit the day before they recorded this? Is that right?
Yeah, apparently so. Mm-hmm.
Which is interesting. It's like a Mike Patton situation, right? Like, here, do you want to sing on this record? By the way, you need to do it tomorrow.
And the only person that's been in since the start is Jeremy Ray Talley, is that right?
Yeah.
Is that the guitarist?
Yeah, he's a guitarist. Yeah. And to be honest, none of them have actually went on to do anything after the band broke up.
It's pretty interesting what they have gone on to do.
Well, James Munoz, he became a stand-up comedian. Apparently, he used to do like stand-up shows with Keith Buckley.
The guy from Every Time I Die.
And he's been on Funny or Die a bunch of times as well.
Yeah, well, so he appears on Funny or Die like semi-regularly. One of them went back to college. One of them, I can't remember. He got like a fairly straight job as well. Mm. Because they were broke after the 2011, after the last album, they were totally skint, mm-hmm. and they broke up. Although the drummer went on to play with Gavin Rossdale a bit,
and he played with My Chemical Romance as well.
Yeah,
he played drums for My. He was kicked out of My Chemical Romance for stealing money from the band.
It's also like this band have always Robin seemed Hood. To have on stage, but also just like throughout their career had this like weird sort of sense of chaos, like running through them. As if they never really had a plan. They were like young guys, not really sure what they were doing.
So I'm going to be honest, right? This is a style of music that I was sort of into this stuff. I was into variations of this stuff prior. Okay, so from like the very late 90s and stuff, I was into things like Vision of Disorder. And this band take a lot from that, a lot of the chops and a lot of the approaches, although the singing parts are done differently. There's more of an emo influence in this, whereas Vision was just a little bit more kind of, I don't know, stodgy maybe. But I don't have a hell of a lot to contribute in the history of the band because it doesn't do that much for me, although I have tried to engage with it. But something did occur to me as I spent a week listening to this, which I will be honest, I found quite fatiguing. I mean, it is not easy music to just listen to back to back to back. And I'm someone that loves Converge. You know, I can listen to that, but I think they've got elements and ingredients and aspects to their music and nuance that this doesn't have.
We can talk about that when
what did strike me is that this is something I'd like to call idcore, right? This is id music. In the Freudian sense of it. I can't think of a genre of music other than maybe some aspects of rap, but certainly in the rock genre, even more so than nu metal, this is like the juvenile id expression. Now, I don't mean like juvenile in the sense of like comedy pop punk and stuff, because there is like a level of ego involved in that. And when nu metal, I think, even though nu metal at times could be incredibly fucking dumb, and definitely reaches the same heights of id that this does, it also tempered it. Like, there is also that ego element of tempering it with aspirations of commercial success. Mm-hmm. So, like, I mean, Limp Bizkit is, at times, completely id, completely stupid, and the basest expression of dumb shit. But also, they clearly had aspirations and clearly modified their sound and clearly wrote structure and verse chorus and injected an element of accessibility, and then some of the other metallic hardcore bands, some of the other kind of post-hardcore bands like At The Drive-In also did that. There's an element, like, they also had a political element, which again shows that ego and even that superego aspect of moderation on the id. But in this, there are, certainly in Past The Flask, I don't think it's the case later on in the albums, but in Past The Flask, there is like no real commercial aspiration. There is definitely a big audience for this stuff, but there's also virtually no growth potential outside of that audience because it alienates the real metalheads. It doesn't appeal to punk rock kids, really. There's no real accessible melody in a proper sense. The audience for it, that little guy, black t-shirt, swinging his arms about pretending he's in a mosh pit when, you know, the big metalheads will say, that's not a real mosh pit, mate. you'll get better than a real mosh pit. Mm-hmm. You know, that it's inherently restricted to that. I don't think it was particularly focused at women. It was very much dominated by little dudes. I'm sure there are loads of girls that were into it, but I just mean over the piece. I think that's fairly accurate to say. So it didn't really have many other considerations. And it was, as we said, apolitical. So there's no real temperance of that. You know, it's chuggy, it's nasty, it's frantic, it's got a kind of, it's got a lack of self-awareness in the kind of way that it just sort of goes for like shouting and screaming to that whiny self-pity that kind of really alienates a lot of people as well. I'm not trying to shit on it, I'm just saying it's very, very much to me the most pure expression of a lack of concern for the other possible potential around it. It's just id music, id core. And I really think that applies to this genre. And I've tried, since I came up with it, I've been trying to like think of other variations of rock music that are anything like as undiluted as that, and I really can't. Mm-hmm. I think it's, especially at this stage, I think from the second album onwards, they started to modify it, and they did kind of toy with the idea, maybe we can be more accessible, you know, the ego did come in. Mm-hmm. And bands like Refused, the super ego of like, the political agendas behind it, that is not there in this band. And it's interesting in that sense. Even the song titles, it's so puerile, it's so self-indulgently stupid. And I don't necessarily mean that in a kind of pejorative sense, but I just mean it's just unconcerned with anything. And I don't know, I find that kind of interesting. I think it's something that alienates me, mm-hmm. as a listener, and I know quite a few people that are alienated by that, even though they like heavy music. And that's why bands like Converge, who had a much more, had like a self-awareness, had another level up of like, right, okay, we've got this, and I think a lot of the parts of this are definitely compatible with that, some fucking great riffs,
yeah.
But they then don't try and evolve it in that self-aware way, that kind of like higher level, I think bands like Botch, for example.
Yeah, no, I agree. I kind of, it's weird looking back at this record and going, oh, where was I as a human being when I was really fucking into this and got it? Because I was 18 years old, I was taking a year out and I was working in the call center in Alness, and I was walking to the call center on rainy November day, listening to this and going, ah, fucking, I love riffs. And I'd also just going, oh, I'm quite miserable. And I was also, you know, you're 18 and you are discovering yourself, that you probably don't really like yourself for a bit. And, you know, oh, fuck, I'll just go to the pub and blah, blah, blah. And also you're stuck in Alness and there's not much heavy music happening up there. So you're like, this is your little thing that you own for the 30 minute walk down to the call centre.
I think that it makes sense that it would appeal to especially teenage boys in that way, because there is so much of a sort of self-serving... I sound like I'm being a pure dick. I'm not. We've been there at least, and 49% of our listeners have been there. But like, what's the word I'm trying to find here? I mean, it is very...
It's incredibly self-absorbed.
It is. It's very self-absorbed as a form of music. And I get it. I get why it was. And I remember loving those riffs. And, you know, I think to have longevity, this kind of music needed that element of ego and superego to get to somewhere more interesting, because it doesn't age that well.
Yeah, it's really interesting, like, looking at the... I was just going through, there were so many bands came out at that time.
Oh, it
was like an absolute avalanche
man.
Of, like, post-hardcore and then the metalcore bands. And it's really interesting seeing the ones that have lasted. And I hate that, you know how that meme of, like, god-tier crisps and then good-tier and then average-tier or whatever. Yeah. But it's like, you've got your god-tier, like, post-hardcore metalcore bands, which will be... Converge, Dillinger Escape Plan, Botch, right? And then like just below that,
well, like Refused and stuff.
And then you've got Poison the Well, Cave In, Killswitch Engage, Fear Before, Glassjaw, Thursday, and then below that you just have this fucking avalanche of stuff like As I Lie Dying, Trivium.
Yeah, it's a
like,
it's a pyramid that just it spreads.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And there's a lot of stuff. The album that I keep going back to that ties to this in terms of like its urgency, it's got that sort of emo part to it, but it's also got the aggressiveness, is Watch Out by Alexis on Fire.
Yeah.
Which is very different in its aesthetic. Mm-hmm. And Alexis on Fire seem to have this cachet afterwards and like got
Can
bigger.
I just check,
and
is it Alexis on fire or Alex is
Alex,
on fire?
Alex on fire, yeah.
Yeah, I always used to think it was Alex is on
Alex
fire.
Alex is on fire, yeah.
I met
That's weird.
My flatmate, he was into this shit.
That's Alexis, our band that the first couple of records haven't really aged that well, but yeah, the later ones when they actually started thinking about writing songs properly and what they could do with having three different vocalists and
case in point, that's exactly what we're talking about. Yeah. It's like where those considerations start to manifest and the albums seem to get another dimension.
Yeah, and I think the Bled, I don't think ever, I mean, they did get more dimensional. I'm not sure if they got better, but they, you know, they tried new things.
As far as I can tell, reviews agree that they never got better, that this was, I mean, this is very much the sort of, Maybe the definitive example of the, let me say reducto ad absurdum, but like the most concentrated, simplified form of this genre.
Yeah,
and I find you.
Yeah, and I think it had a lot of potential, and I think a lot of bands worked on this blueprint and came out with interesting things. Some of them came up with just 15 years of shit. Mm. The Bled themselves are not the band that made the most out of this template.
Absolutely not. No.
It's really interesting going back and finding this 2003 record that had taken like influences from metal and from hardcore and from post-hardcore and like in a very, that very sort of single-minded, self-absorbed way just created this album out of anger and sort of narcissism and also, you know, some really good, interesting musical things going on as well as just like fucking breakdowns.
And then
what can be made of that? A lot of stuff got made out of that.
They're very much a stepping stone, I think. Even at this early stage in the appraisal of it, I agree, it became very apparent how significant an album this was. Not that it was the first of that ilk, but it certainly was the most solid example of that ilk at this point and became really
quite
pivotal.
Refined. It was like a really refined point for this kind of music. That's one of the reasons why I picked it, is because it encapsulates possibly the end of a kind of scene that was happening, but also something which would go on to define like a huge amount of other music at the back of it.
Yeah. Because there were a lot of bands like doing quite similar things, like Thursday, From Autumn to Ashes.
There was bands like Drowning Man as well that were like a bit further down the scale. They also captured that aesthetic of like the ridiculously long track names, that kind of like sort of slightly, it's not comical, but there is a very soft level of comedy to using those sort of titles, you know.
Yeah.
Especially in like the second track in this, you know, it's like that aspect of it, that was there and it kind of vanished and it was very much of its time. Can we just very quickly talk about the other records? Because Found in the Flood, I noticed that they went in a very Glassjaw direction with the vocals.
Glassjaw, definitely in the vocals. And
it's
also
2005, right? So I don't. Yeah. We were Glassjaw in 2005.
They were.
Worship and Tribute was maybe 2003, I think.
If that's the case, then Glassjaw weren't a band at this point. Then I want to talk a little bit about Glassjaw. Just
Worship and Tribute was 2002. So
Glassjaw weren't a band anymore.
Glassjaw had split up.
Yeah.
There's also big refuse things happening in there as well, like the riffs rather than the, you know, higher up the fret. But
there was
like
there's a track on it, number 4, Antarctica, which sounds really like Deftones.
I was thinking that as well, actually. On that record, Hotel Coral Essex is probably one of my favourite Bled songs because you can see it should fit on Past the Flask.
Yeah, and Last American Cowboy as well. That's still their most played on Spotify, I think. And that's like a big Bled song. It's got the big chorus and it does like the same sort of thing as Sound of Sulphur or Never Met Another Gemini on this record.
I noticed this is the first time that they got the label melodic metalcore.
Yeah.
As well. A few folk tried to make
which
that.
Which is weird.
Nonsense.
But he does push his melodic vocals in this and I don't think it quite works.
Oh my God. Spidey, can we just please stop and take note of a track called My Assassin.
Which
is so fucking bad. It defies fucking belief how fucking truly awful that song is. I know he's going for the glass jaw thing. I mean, the mix alone is poor in it because the vocals are way too naked. The vocal take is terrible. It's out of tune. The writing on it is fucking dreadful. It's about as bad an example I've heard of that sort of whiny emo take on metalcore ever. Yeah. I mean, it's truly fucking dreadful.
Yeah, his vocals just, I think they quite work on Past the Flask when he's just pushing it, and they sound like a strained sort of cross between screaming and shouting, but when he goes full melodic on this, it's just like too,
it's not all
really
like,
eggy, can't really sing.
It's not all like that, but fucking hell, that song is absolutely catastrophically bad. It's fucking terrible.
They're definitely a band which has diminishing returns when it comes to albums after Past the Flask.
Silent Treatment got some pretty decent reception.
It's got
2007,
production's really good on it.
The first 30 seconds of this album, I was like totally sitting up and taking note. Like the first track, was
Shade
it called
Tree Mechanics?
Shade Tree Mechanics. Yeah. Fucking, it starts so well and it sounds like they're doing something really different. Like they're like, okay, we'll do it.
Yeah, big expansive open chords.
But it fucking just reverts to type after about 40 seconds and it was so disappointing. Fuck, man. And then, to be honest, the rest of the thing just really passed me by.
I think You Should Be Ashamed of Myself was pretty cool. But I think, Dave, you mentioned it earlier on before we started recording. It's like they'd already done it and they're just trying to do it again.
They're not really
adding anything else to the palette, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And I felt like their guitarist was like the only guy that's stayed with them throughout the records, and he kind of keeps going back and relying on the same little riff and the same little breakdown and the de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de-de- doing the same
thing for 6 years.
You're like, all right, yeah. We could do with some some more stuff happening.
They kind of veered away from the as much overt melody, and I say melody in inverted commas, in comparison to Found in the Flood, though. Mm-hmm. Like, this was a little bit straighter and harder and less of that whining and trying to sing.
Well, they got Mark Trombino on board for Found in the Flood, right? So that's like the big Jimmy World, Blink-182 producer. You're thinking... I often kind of get the impression that Pass the Flask was only supposed to be an album, like you said, like just for them. I don't think they really expected much to happen after it. But then clearly somebody's went, by the way, you and me have something. So, and then they get signed to Vagrant, which is at the time was
a large
distributed
indie.
By BMG, before Sony owned BMG. And somebody may have said to them, like, if you do something here, you might be able to go to the next level. And they obviously never did it because they just couldn't, they just didn't have it.
But they got enough opportunities.
So he was the right guy to get. I mean, the guy's got an outstanding back catalogue and pedigree. Yeah.
And they also got enough opportunities. You know, they were on that, like, Project Revolution tour with Linkin Park, and then they were on, like, the Taste of Chaos with all those bands. But as I say, like, I also always felt like they weren't a band that were built for that. Like, there was no great artistic goal in this band.
I mean, as Mark says, that partly comes from the fact that they were not really setting out to do anything big, and then partly from that the nature of that early music, that it was so, so totally blinkered.
Yeah.
Can we just intervene?
Oh, yeah. If you are hearing...
We are not broadcasting from Raqqa. It is currently fireworks...
Guy Fawkes.
Bonfire Night in the UK, Guy Fawkes Night, and that is the night that Ned's in the street typically set off fireworks that some guy in a corner shop sold them that he wasn't meant to.
Yeah.
So you may hear a little
happening right now.
You may hear a little bit of gunfire. But yeah, we're just going to press on.
But yeah, because the Bled and Pass the Flask was that, like, sort of, for them, that perfect distillation of, like, 19-year-old rage, when they're, you know, 10 years later, or, you know, when they're in their late 20s and they've got a bigger studio and a bigger budget and blah, 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 then you can't do what you were doing before. Like, that's not the vibe that you had.
Yeah. So. Well, see, interestingly, when they brought out Heat Fetish, the fourth album in 2010, the reaction that I saw in the reviews at the time, the contemporary reviews, were that they were a band who'd been lost in the wilderness a bit since this first unexpected success of Pass the Flask. And they struggled to sort of know what direction to go in. Are we just going to keep doing this? No, we can't do that. We have to go somewhere. But they didn't really know what to do. And it didn't seem to come very naturally to them. Certainly not as naturally as it came to some of their contemporaries. Mm-hmm. In saying that, Heat Fetish was fairly warmly received. People said it was a fairly rejuvenated sounding act. It was nothing new, but it was strong.
There were more ideas in one song than there were on the last record. You know, they were putting more things were happening. Just to me, it didn't really tie together.
They got some three songs are really good on it, I think.
Yeah. They got some serious comparisons to Every Time I Die in this record.
Yeah,
though.
You can hear that as their career goes on as well. You can definitely hear them getting more. It's as Every Time I Die started to sound less like Every Time I Die, more like a fucking southern rock band.
Yeah, like
to sound
they just
more like Every Time I Die.
Yeah, using that sort of classic blues rock riff, but in a metalcore standard. Mm-hmm. Then, like every time I Die, were like that, the totem of that. I mean, and then a lot of bands started to just rely on that sort of pentatonic scale.
Do you remember Maylene and the Sons of Disaster?
I do indeed. Yeah.
They were one of those.
Were they not like the members of the Chariot in that band, I think?
Yeah, they had like three guitarists and stuff like that. They were fucking, everything about them was just like completely fucking pointless. But they wrote a couple of decent tunes, but they released like three records and it was like, what are you doing? Why are you still doing
stop it.
So like, this is an example of a sound that spawned literally thousands of imitators. I mean, these are just the ones that we heard. Mm-hmm. You can imagine in towns and cities all over the world, there were loads of groups of wee guys doing exactly this.
And we had like the Taste of Chaos tour, and we had all these fucking corporate packaged things, and, you know, relentless, you know, juice and monster energy and all that.
At the same time,
came out, it was
going
all
those
fucking
big tour buses that were sponsored by Rockstar, you know, like that kind of stuff.
It's just really funny that, like, this genre that took basically the sound of Refused and the sound of At the Gates, like two At the Gates riffs, and melded them. It just created an entire genre of, well, it's like an ecosystem or like a fucking, a total economy the size of a small country, just, you know, based on, you know, fringes and studded belts. And
I mean, what a population that would be. I have to say, by this point in their career, I'm like, do I, or does anyone really need this record? I mean, if you're already really attached to the band, that's one thing, but there are so many options that sound virtually identical. And it's doing so little new.
Yeah.
I'm like, what is the point? And I think they kind of got that vibe as well.
I think they came in that realization and were like, I think we just patch a guy.
Yeah, I really have always wanted to play drums for Gavin Rossdale, the singer for Bush. I need to go.
I do like the quote that they had when they got it was just Munoz and the guitarist Tally who were left, and they got the two new guys in, and they said before Heat Fetish came out that they wanted to rock by any means necessary. And continue being in the Bled. And I'm like, oh, 2002, the Bled would not have wanted to rock by any means necessary.
Jinx.
So, shit, that one nearly took the window out.
It's a good one, eh?
So I was going to say, like, do you think, see when these guys are on like tours like Project Revolution and Taste of Chaos, they're like the odd kid in the class, right? It's like, who the fuck are these guys? Do you think if they hadn't got that taste of success, they might have just been a bit more interesting as they evolved?
I wonder if they'd continued being a DIY band and playing like, you know, little 200 venues around the country, then maybe they just have been a fucking great sweaty hardcore band rather than being having these aspirations of, oh, we've shared a stage with Blink-182, so we should probably write a big song.
I've got that guy's phone number for that record label, so maybe we should do something.
I kind of feel like they would just have sort of like fizzled out as like a wee guy's band and then just done normal jobs.
I don't know. I wonder
that, but bands like Alex and Fire never did that, but they were afforded the same privileges as I guess as the Bled did, but they were they always had one ear towards like writing really big hooky choruses.
I think the thing that makes me think that though is that the lineup in the Bled was always so unstable. I think the band was kept together by the success rather than the success being a result of the band.
I totally always got that vibe. Yeah. They were like this album was a sort of success of circumstance and then everything else was about to fall apart from it.
And I think they stuck at it maybe longer than most bands would because they were like, well, we've still kind of got attention. We should probably just try it one more time. When your lineup is this removed from the original lineup, when you've had multiple people leave multiple positions and you're basically got one person that's still in it, I'm not so sure. If they hadn't had success earlier on, I don't think they would have lasted.
I would love to see, do a documentary on where are all of these bands now. Like all these bands that were idolised and played third on the bill at the ABC, sponsored by Relentless, Horse the Band and Heavy Heavy Low Low and The Number 12 Looks Like You.
Number 12 Looks Like You are still going.
God Forbid.
They were a weird band though.
He is Legend and A Static Lullaby and Still Remains and The Agony Scene and It Dies Today and Seosin.
It's quite depressing.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a
half
German...
Half those bands are still going.
Exactly. I mean, fucking hell. But there's like a German word, I'm pretty sure, for... when you're in a crowd or when you look through a window of a high-rise flat or something like that and you're overwhelmed by the sheer number of lives that there are on Earth and you can't contemplate that every single person has a story and a life story like you do and you're like, oh no, there's too many people in the world. That band, that word, in relation to metalcore bands from 2005... is like a whole other
that word
thing.
That word core.
That word core, exactly. Yeah. I mean, fucking hell. I can't imagine all of these bands had guitar techs. All of these bands had, you know,
to a manager.
Vans.
Yeah, to a manager.
Exactly.
Their girlfriend that managed them for 6 months. All right, so pass the flask.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Well, I took like, I think. I suppose... let me start that again. I'm just trying to think about the best way of phrasing this.
Mark's like a scared pet.
the fireworks are fucking me up now. I was in a hardcore band before and my flatmate's still in a really, really good hardcore band. And whenever I hear...
By the way, just since you said that, Dave's now staring at the window thinking about all those lives.
Oh, man. I know.
And a lot of hardcore bands that are kicking around just now... bits of them remind me of this record, so I thought I thought about this record and thought, well, I think it'd be quite good for this, mostly because I think they are an unsung band because there's a lot of influence from this record that's been on, as we said, to spread. And do I think they'd really deserve to be known for that, having an influence? Probably not. I think there's more influential bands than them, but I think it's a really interesting like distillation of this scene at that time, and I think some of the riffs in this record still hold up today.
I also think it was a hugely influential scene. A lot of people got into like shit metalcore for a while and then found other things. I know for exactly.
There's still loads of shit metalcore.
Absolutely. But I remember
the crab dance if it hadn't been for these guys.
But when I was 19, I moved to Stirling and went to uni, and in 1 year, I came through to the garage and I saw As I Lie Dying, Trivium, Bullet for My Valentine, Finch. It Dies Today, The Agony Scene. I think I've seen like 14 or 15 of these identikit like metalcore bands, and it was just like a weird time where it was like such a big thing, and then
little gang bands
exactly
and then everybody's fucking ripping their songs off of like Kazaa or Soul Seek or
I was finding you know the top three on LimeWire and downloading them,
and a whole bunch of bands have sprung up because of that like file sharing thing, and that's a reason, I think a reason why a band like the Bled could tour over here is probably because of that. It's not because they're selling fucking records. You know what I mean?
They did say that that they wanted to get this album out before the internet got big.
Before the industry collapsed. So Red Wedding, which I don't believe is the original title of that track.
I think you're right, but I can't remember how I know remember. That.
Yeah, it's some sort of political decision that made them change it. I can't remember what it was.
They've had a few name changes on this record.
We'll talk about the next one.
But Red Wedding's a pretty solid start.
Yeah.
That's aggressive.
Like, it reminds me of a little bit of a mix between, as I mentioned, Vision of Disorder and like the Imprint album from 1998 and some of the kind of uber earnest vocal stuff of Boys Set Fire. That kind
I
of,
never see one of the things that as someone as a singer, one of the things that I really liked about this record is I didn't really care about the vocals very much. I was all about the riffs.
Yeah.
An odd thing for me to say.
Absolutely not, but I mean it's totally true. I mean the riffs are the standout feature in this.
Yeah.
This album is completely held together by the
absolutely.
But there's like two or three songs where I do really like the sort of melodic chorus of it, but it's because it doesn't stray too far into that sort of cheesy melody. It's just a strained scream rather than a scream.
Well, they basically set out the blueprint for like how their songs are going to go on this, like this, right? So you've got like a kind of weird mathcore converge bit, then you've got like a slower kind of bit, and then you'll have like a beat down.
Yeah.
And then like it'll just kind of rinse repeat, like just like cut and paste, you know what I mean? But there's a lot, I think, one of the things that really enamoured me to this band at the time, and still kind of do now, is like the kind of weird interesting guitar parts, like the weird melodies he sometimes just chucks out like offhand. I think that actually works better on this record than any other one that did afterwards.
Yeah, definitely. And it's also, because it's the production is like less bombastic, you just hear it clearer. You you've got the rhythm guitar, and then you've got a couple of like weird high up bits going on. Weird high up bits. And I'm really on it today.
You're using your words.
As someone that was obviously quite liked like a lot of the same music around about this time, this band stood out because they messed about with the strong structure, which a lot of bands were doing more conventionally. This was quite unconventional. I'm not saying it was hugely like different, because bands like Converge and bands like Dillinger Escape Plan were doing that, but given the company they were keeping, nobody else was really doing this at the time, and that's one of the reasons why I liked it. Yeah, and then you've got like there's a bit in the middle where there's like a weird slowdown, and you get the big heavy like.
And then just a true, like,
they use that technique.
And massively emo lyrics.
Yeah.
What's a fucking, Close Your Eyes and Die or something like that? Yeah.
I mean, yeah, some of the lyrics on this are like hilariously awful, but I mean, you're also just like, oh, I'm 18 and I'm got this pumped up loud and like,
I see.
What a fucking riff.
I wonder if part of that is being self-conscious as well, because like James is a comedy writer, he's always been a comedian. I wonder if he's like deliberately fucking with us and going, by the way, this is like the most cliche thing I can think of in a space of a day.
I think we're giving a bit too much agency to him.
I don't know, like, man, like the second song was called Daily Hernhardt's Seatbelt.
Well, I think the title of the second song is like very tongue-in-cheek, and the approach to changing it to You Know Who's Seatbelt, you know, I get it. So this is a guy that died whilst playing his Tamagotchi, is that right?
No, it was called Dale Earnhardt's Seatbelt. Dale Earnhardt was a very, very famous NASCAR driver.
He died whilst feeding a Tamagotchi.
He died of his injuries that he sustained in a crash at Daytona 500.
He wasn't doing his Tamagotchi at the Daytona 500.
Apparently he was feeding the Tamagotchi.
Where have you got this from? We're going to have to do a fact check here. Dale Earnhardt. Death of Dale Earnhardt. Death. During the Daytona 500 on February 2001, Earnhardt was killed in a three-car crash on the final lap of the race, collided with Ken Schrader, because he was feeding his Tamagotchi. No, he was not feeding his Tamagotchi. He was doing the fucking Indy 500, the
look
Daytona 500.
Up, look up Earnhardt feeding Tamagotchi.
Tamagotchi.
You guys can just listen to the sound of fireworks in the background, though.
No. Google does not commit any result.
Jury's out.
I mean, the jury's out and going, What is Chris on about? What the fuck's he talking about?
Do you remember
about?
Tamagotchis?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know what? I was talking about that today because they came out
they
the
were
same...
big.
They came out the same Christmas as Wrigley's Airwaves chewing gum. And I had a Wrigley's Airwaves chewing gum today and it reminded me of Tamagotchis.
Dale Earnhardt was trying to feed his Tamagotchi so it didn't die during the Daytona 500 and he crashed.
I'm calling shenanigans on that.
So
anyway, a seatbelt. Yeah. Let's talk about your seatbelt.
This is like the fundamental text for this kind of music, yeah. And it's such a distilled version of what this sound should be.
Yeah,
yeah. But the drumming stands apart from a lot of other bands in this genre. Especially in this song, is ace.
Well, I think on this record, that's one thing that they had that the Fallen records didn't, was they had like that urgency, and it sounded like they were playing live in a room and they were fucking on it. Whereas when they maybe had that space to sit down and record, they lost that chaotic energy that sort of held them together in the beginning, and they just sounded like a band going, "Oh, maybe we could put that riff in." Whereas this just sounded like four people going very fast.
Yeah.
It does have a little bit more of an injection of melody in this one as well.
Yeah, there's a bit in the second verse, kind of like around 1:30, where they kind of switch up the arrangement, and it does like this really big ascending thing, and then everything, like the bass and the two guitars are playing like three completely different melodies, which is like really, really cool. And then you've got like a kind of weird mathcore beat down at the end as well, which again, nobody else was really doing at that time who were contemporaries of, who are, I wouldn't say contemporaries of theirs, but like basically bands that they would be playing with. Another thing you think about is like, these are guys in the fucking middle of nowhere, Tucson, Arizona. Like, what the fuck business have they got playing music like this? This is the kind of tunes that would be coming from like a big cultural hub.
Yeah.
Like New York, fucking Los Angeles or whatever.
Yeah.
You're talking about kind of decent guitar interplay earlier on. I think the third track, I Never Met Another Gemini, is one of the better examples of guitar.
Yeah, this
guitar is feeding and intertwining.
This is one of my favourite tracks when I was listening to the album back in the day.
But the vocals are fucking stinking.
Ah, see, I don't mind the vocals because it just adds up that wee bit of melody that you kind of want. But yeah, it sort of, it comes in at this very immediate track, very urgent track. And it's got like the sort of the big power chords, but the tapping that's happening, like it's fucking like Thunderstruck by AC/DC.
I'm making myself laugh thinking about the Tamagotchi thing. Because if that turns out to be wrong, I'm going to be like,
I mean, I'm intrigued.
Did I black out or something? Like, was this a dream?
But yeah, then they, like, as the verse is going through, you've got that wee tapping, which is very AC/DC Thunderstruck, actually. But
I hate AC/DC
as well, but this is better than AC/DC.
Oh, yeah. And when they drop the melody bit in this, it sounds fucking epic, man.
Yeah.
With that kind of off time beat down again. Written down here, which
middle bit is quite unremarkable.
I was written down here, his singing voice just isn't the best.
No.
At all. It does get better as the career of the band goes on.
Mm-hmm.
He always learns to sing a bit more, but it's not very good here.
Ruth Buzzy, better watch her back.
Yeah.
It's a quote from Wet Hot American Summer, is that right?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Which is like, that's a, thinking about it way back then, that's a deep cut reference, man. Like, nobody would have got that.
But it's also that kind of really dumb childish id thing that I was talking about. It's like, yeah, it's kind of flippant, it's apolitical, it's just like this really sort of naff fucking reference. This one, actually, one thing I will say, musically, I had time for this because it was the one that felt the most authentically old school. Mm-hmm. So going back maybe 5 years prior to the bands that really kicked off, not this sound, but the precursor to this sound. It felt the truest to those influences. The really chuggy bit in the middle felt quite authentic to that. Like they were wearing their influences in their sleeve. And there's a really good beat down in this at 2:10 as well. It's it's one of the...
I've got that as well, like pure converged style sort of thing. I found one of the things I found interesting about this is like it's got like 8 different separate sections within the first minute. It's like just completely different things they're doing, like a bit of this, a bit of that, a bit of this. Then you've got the big beep down, and then another beat down. The one you're talking about, Chris, the drumming again is fucking insane in that song. Like Mike Petticone, despite the fact he may allegedly be a thief, is a fantastic.
I don't hold
drummer.
It against him because he stole from a band that deserved to be robbed.
And they've never reunited. They're going to rob loads of people.
Should drop them a bit harder. Sound of Suffer.
Sulfur.
Sulfur?
Yeah, Sound of Sulfur. And Sulfur.
Sulfur's better.
Sulfur's spelt wrong as well, which is really strange.
Oh, well. It's spelled really wrong in my page because I've written Suffer. But
the drums on that, this isn't the favourite drum take on this record.
I think it's one of the less remarkable songs on it, to be honest.
It's one of the most played ones because it's got that melody in the middle and the sort of that,
big emo end.
To be honest, the real standout for me in this one was the size of the beatdown in it. The beatdown in it is it's pure pit
pretty
carnage.
Hectic.
It's one of those ones where you're like, when they start playing it, you back away towards the bar.
If
you want to finish your drink, you're like, right. And people start wondering, people that don't know about the catalogue are like, where's that guy going? He knows the tune.
Getting the fuck out of the way.
Track 6, Porcelain Hearts and Hammers for Teeth. I think it's the best tune on it.
That's got the most emo song title in the whole fucking world.
Yeah, I know.
Like, it's very off the era.
Is it emo though? It hammers for teeth. It's not a very emo thing.
Bands are from up to Ashes and their training stuff were doing like song titles.
But you know, it's
like,
got that opening lyric.
That's just fucking metal, is it?
There's nothing more emo than I'd burn alive to keep you warm, baby. You know, so.
Touches.
But hey, that got me when I was 18 because I lived in a very cold part of the house.
And look how you turned out.
Exactly.
See, when the big riff comes in at 2:20, man, it's like fire breathing.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a more adventurous song overall, I think.
This is basically
got a great ending. It's a really good ending, this one. What I will say, I noticed some interesting comments about this online. People who were ripping this off things like LimeWire and Kazaa thought that there was a problem with the torrent because for some reason the sound of this track stands out amongst the rest of the album. Like, it's substantially poorer, the quality.
Yeah.
It's I don't know, maybe sometimes these things happen at the mix, especially if the mix wasn't done in one long, you know, session, if it was done bit by bit or revisions were made. But this track has like a different sound quality that totally. Maybe...
But also, I mean, this is the first one where they've got clean guitars on it and stuff like that, so maybe...
Yeah, maybe it was overdone.
Maybe they had a different approach separately. To recording it.
It's a shame because I think it's the strongest song, but it suffers from the audio quality.
It sounds like, the vocal sounds like... It's got distortion and so much compression on it that it sounds like it's got a lisp almost. Like the
You've
screaming.
Mentioned this before, actually.
When he's screaming, but it's like and Sharon Van Etten and Chelsea Wolfe, that's deliberate. Like, that's a deliberate thing that's been done. This, I just think but it's probably just bad production. Because it does sound really strange. But you're right, I think it's probably one of the best songs on the record.
Yeah, I think it's the best constructed song. It's just a pity how the mix turned out. Get Up, what is it? Get Up, You Son of a Bitch.
Because Mickey Loves You.
Because Mickey Loves
From Rocky 1 or 2, I can't remember.
Right, okay, Rocky something.
But that's a minute and a half of just hardcore.
Just mad.
Doesn't really do anything for me, to be honest with you. There's a pretty kind of interesting dragged sort of time stretched staccato chug in it, but I mean it's nothing that's not been done a million times. Spit Shine Sonata.
The first line, I lost my voice in a fire, is kind of funny, I think. I lost my voice. I liked it.
It's good. Yeah. It's all right. This is a song that I think sounds as close to most of the people that rip them off as any, certainly from this album. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, I'm not like, it's not their fault that people ripped them off, but this song is lost amidst the fucking deluge of stuff that came after it.
Yeah,
you know I mean,
it's probably the most measured. And it sounds even more measured because of the insanity of the last song, which is just a minute 30 of chaos. But it's got a really cool flow between the heavy bits and the kind of stop-start nature of the verses. And then the big beatdown at the end again. There's some really cool discordant double stops as well, which I really like, which you don't really do very much on this record anyway.
Yeah.
Which is pretty cool. Like, it's like like a mad spidery riff, then a double stop, and then I'm doing it again. I'm like, how the fuck could you play that? Like, it's like, that would just cripple my hand.
Yeah. Definitely get.
Maybe he's got extra hands.
Maybe.
That could be it.
Maybe he's got extra fingers.
Then We Are the Industry sort of adds a bit of.
Should it end it
dynamic.
With this song?
Yeah, it's a really good album ender, I think, actually.
I like the title.
Yeah.
I
quite like the vocals in this. I don't mind it. It's like subdued a lot. Yeah, it adds something to this record that was lacking before.
This was always phenomenal live because of that big sing along at the end. Used to play it last, and it was like, yeah, we get it.
You guys get it.
And then Nothing We See Leaves This Room, which is kind of cool. I was always confused as to why this was here, because We Are the Industry should probably be last.
Yeah, you could have swapped them around easily.
The first riff is really cool with the fast bit.
Yeah,
I like it. I like a fast beat. And then but there's just a lot of ideas on here that do better elsewhere, so it feels like it's just kind of tagged on. And see, when you think about how Hotel Carolessics is not on this record,
but they'd already written it.
Definitely be there.
Yeah,
because totally. That song is an absolute beast.
Yeah.
It's probably worth mentioning, like, as well, that the reissue of this with the 10 songs taken from the first two EPs, I think actually some of those songs are pretty strong.
There's some interesting stuff.
They're quite you know, some of them are ready, quite unevolved, but there's actually some really interesting insights into where they were coming from in there. Mm-hmm. It's a bit like when you listen to the older Botch stuff and the kind of outtakes stuff, you know. There's some really, you know, it's not nearly as consistent throughout, but, you know, every so often they stumble across something that's like a big evolutionary step forward for them.
Yeah.
So I think the long version of it doesn't hold up as a back-to-back listen. It's fucking exhausting.
Yeah.
But it does for the completist or for the fan or even just somebody on a nostalgia cruise. You do find some kind of really interesting bits and bobs in there. I'm glad they stopped it at 10, but I will say that given that I'm not the biggest fan of it, the style, let alone the record, I found it really hard going to listen to it multiple times. And I did listen to it multiple times, but I felt thoroughly fatigued.
Well, it's funny how, kind of going back to it after, nearly 15 years, more than 15 years.
16.
Oh, God, I'm so old.
Hey, fuck you.
It was more one-dimensional than I remember it being. Mm-hmm. I remember it when it came out, I was like, oh, this is up there. This is like the cross between Converge and At the Drive-In that I've been looking for the whole time. And then going back to it, I'm like, oh, it never got near either of those bands.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It does one thing really fucking well.
Yeah.
So here is the twist in the tale then, right? Because I totally agree with that. I'm a fan of At the Drive-In. I'm a huge fan of Converge. And I totally agree with you. It's very one-dimensional. And it's for that reason that I'm actually going to say yes, I think it should go in, because I think, I don't like it, but objectively speaking, I think it is one of the most concise summations of a style of music that, whether you like it or not, was significant to a lot of people and has had a bearing on a hell of a lot of music that followed it. And this is really one of the touchstones. Like, if you were trying to pick maybe like three albums that really formed the basis for a whole movement of bands, this has to be in
there. Yeah, it's a very precise time capsule.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. On its own, do I ever want to hear it again?
Probably not.
Not fucked, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think it's terrible. I think some of the riffs and beatdowns especially are great, but I like them done elsewhere where there's a bit more going on.
Yeah.
But I do completely acknowledge that it is a very simple constituent part, but a very important part of a lot of music that followed it.
I'm glad you see it the same way I did.
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm trying to be objective about it. I appreciate its value in that sense, even though I don't want to hear it.
Yeah.
Really.
Do you know, the band that I always compare them to, of the same sort of time, are Poison the Well. Mm-hmm. And Poison the Well's first record, Opposite of December, was it does the beatdowns maybe better, or it's like, but it doesn't have any of the other parts on it. It's just like a pure fucking emo metalcore
record, totally.
And I love that record. And then the second album, Tear from the Red, is kind of what I feel like this record is, but doesn't do it as well. But then Poison the Well then went on to do You Come Before You, which I think is a fucking incredible album. And the Bled never went on to do that. Mm. I think Found in the Flood compared to You Come Before You is like a very pale imitation of.
Can I just say, it was trying to expand, but I think ultimately what it did was dilute their significance.
Yeah,
dilute
absolutely.
Their relevance.
That Tear from the Red album by Poison the Well just doesn't define this time or genre as well as this record does, which is why I'd put it in.
Mm. Well, I think basically, Chris, you've kind of summed up what I was going to say. But also, just to add to that, is I do like the record. It's not as good as I remember, obviously, because I'm older now. I'm getting grey. I'm a bit wiser, I suppose.
You've got a super ego.
I wear silver. I wear suits with stars on them. My stylist would not have liked that suit.
Imagine going to one of their shows with your hair sprayed silver.
I think one of the reasons I picked this is because I don't think we're going to cover this genre very much, if at all, in particular this time period within this genre.
Yeah, looking back at the amount of bands there were and then going, oh, how many great records were produced that I would still listen to? Not many.
Yeah, so for that, that's one of the reasons why I went for it, because I was like, it was quite a... It played a huge part in a lot of bands. Even bands that sound nothing like this were influenced by either by this band or bands that came alongside the Bled. I have no desire to revisit any of that part of my youth ever again.
We've mentioned Chips a number of times in this podcast. but I do think that listening to the Bled is like the sort of analogous to being hungry and buying chips. It's not fulfilling any other nutritional needs. It's not particularly good for you. You're not really going anywhere with it. Yeah. You're not developing any of
but
your...
it's quick and it's satisfying.
It's quick and satisfying and basic and chunky. And that's it. It's just carbs. It's just like, fuck it.
Yeah.
And it's good chips. It's like a good, well-cooked French fry. Basic as fuck.
I would even say chunky chippy chips.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. I mean, chips. Just chips. What? You can't get one with chips, mate.
Just use a bag of chips, mate.
Yeah.
So I think this should go in.
I mean, I'll side with it. I've made my, you know, that's with caveats, but yeah, overall.
And me too.
Excellent.
So what I will say is I put more effort into the
Nexus.
The Nexus this week because I didn't really have a lot to add musically. Yeah, and my Nexus is a fucking diamond. I got maximum Nazi in my Nexus.
Fucking hell. Of course.
This is the first time we're seeing Nexus tonight. Will it be the last? What do they have in store for us?
Not good for-
Why am I here?
You're in the Nexus.
This is the Nexus.
For you, this is what you want.
So, Mark, who are we trying to get from?
We're going from the Bled to Warren Ellis, the writer, as suggested by the North Race on Twitter. So
that's Warren Ellis, not the member of Dirty Three.
The writer, comic book man.
I mean, Warren Ellis from Dirty Three may also be a writer. And
yeah, that's true.
I feel hard done by.
Possibly.
Right. I'm sure he can, right?
Yeah.
So, you take it away.
Yeah, so, as I've mentioned before, I kind of showed my hand a little bit. Mike Pedicone played in this band. He also would later go on to drum for and be kicked out of My Chemical Romance. When My Chemical Romance started to gain recognition, Gerard Way went on to write a comic book series called The Umbrella Academy, which started in 2011. One of his biggest influences as a writer is Grant Morrison, and Grant Morrison actually appears in the video for the song Na Na Na, which is on their last record, Danger Days. Do you know much about Grant Morrison?
Mm-hmm. Nope.
He's fucking mental.
Yeah, a wee bit.
The guy's absolutely insane. He's also from Glasgow.
And doesn't speak to Mark Miller.
Mm-hmm.
You can't put them in the same room together.
Interesting.
I did a comic thing a while back and literally that it was like, you actually can't put them in a building together. Like, they will fucking go at each other like a couple of cats.
I mean, Grant Morrison's a far superior writer to Mark Miller, I think, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, I'm sure that's what Grant would say.
He's also a massive psychonaut. Like, he's well into these drugs and stuff. Or used to be anyway.
Allegedly.
Used to be in a band called The Mixers and used to play around a lot with them in the 80s, and that's when he started to write for the Dundee-based comic book company, DC Thompson, who did The Beano.
My auntie used to work for DC Thompson, actually.
The Bruins, Urwally, and Desperate Dan. After he did that, he started to work for 2000 AD and eventually was spotted by DC Comics and did a really good sort of Batman one-shot called Arkham Asylum, A Serious House and Serious Earth. And he's written a ton of amazing stuff. His Batman stuff is really, really good, actually. He was responsible for a huge arc called Batman R.I.P. His Batman and Robin run with the Glaswegian artist Frank Quitely is really good as well, and Frank Quitely is a fucking great artist. Yeah, he's actually based in Glasgow. Like, he actually does a lot of his work in Glasgow. Yeah. Anyways, one of his most recent things is a comic called Happy, which has turned into a TV show. I don't know if you know about it, but it's about an alcoholic cop who sees his kid's imaginary friend when she gets kidnapped.
It's really John Hamm.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's Christopher Maloney that plays the guy, and Patton Oswalt who plays Happy, the unicorn.
What am I thinking of? What a mess.
The art on that series was done by Derek Robinson, who's a great artist. He's worked quite extensively with Garth Ennis on stuff like The Boys, Punisher Max and all that. But he also worked with Warren Ellis on Transmetropolitan, which is like one of his kind of most defining comics. It's also really good. And the lead character kind of looks a little bit like Grant Morrison, which is also weird.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So, Warren Ellis.
Yeah. Warren Ellis.
Dave, you want to go? Mine's an epic, man.
Okay, of course it is. It's your birthday, so you're allowed to go epic.
Thank you.
On Past the Flask, in the credits, Ryan Joseph Shaughnessy was credited as the photographer. I can't remember what the photos looked like. I think there was like a sweaty photo of the band, maybe. But Ryan Joseph Shaughnessy is an American photographer. He's directed some short films and stuff like that, but he's pretty well known, done some interesting art exhibitions, but he's also done a lot of like global campaigns for fucking everybody from Levi's to Apple, and then he's done stuff with, you know, Spin, Vice, all that. He's also done some photography with hip-hop acts such as Lil Wayne and Odd Future. Odd Future, the LA-based collective that include, you know, folks like Earl Sweatshirt, Sid, and probably most famously, Tyler, the Creator. Tyler, the Creator, an odd man from Odd Future.
Very odd man.
Is he a homophobe? Is he a gay man? Is he talking about rape both in an ironic way?
Maybe,
or
he's all three.
Who knows? One thing he was
so
not.
I would suggest that Milo Yiannopoulos is all three.
Well, yeah.
And yeah, quite comfortably.
Prime
so
back.
One thing Tyler.
Also because it's all right, not because he's gay. I should clarify that.
One thing that Tyler, the Creator, was not was allowed into the UK when he was banned.
Is Milo?
I think Milo's also been banned, yeah.
How can he be banned from the UK? He's a UK citizen.
No, he's not. No. Not anymore.
Is he not?
I think he took a US citizenship.
Really? But yeah, he tried to get in to do a tour in 2013, I think. No, 2015. And he was, his visa was cancelled on the behest of Theresa May.
Can I press the cancel buzzer?
Yes.
Yes, I'm not pressing that in ages. Can someone mention Prince?
And they were informed of the ban via a letter from Theresa May directly saying that his music promoted violence and misogyny.
Really? He was cancelled? He was banned from the UK just for being a homophobe?
By Theresa May.
That's
by the Conservative
ridiculous.
Government.
I mean, don't get me wrong, I've no time for homophobes, but I mean, the UK is fucking full of them.
Yeah.
And like,
that very government.
I'd say at least like half our politicians are fucking virulent homophobes.
I hope the letter like starts with Mr. the Creator.
I hope it starts with dear pot, this is Mrs. Kettle.
So Theresa May, I mean, she had a golden period.
One of the best.
One of the best. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
What a premiership she had. And one of my favourite parts of that was her fucking stupid little kneel bow thing, you know, what, a curtsy to the Queen.
Yeah.
When she like leaned forward and then she was photoshopped in a very awkward position in front of all things. But I mean,
mine was a dancing.
Yeah, she's, oh, Jesus Christ, Theresa May. But yeah, that image of her sort of looking like the Quirtop man, you know, that game where you try and run and press all the bands and she's just about to fall into the Queen. The Queen, her Majesty Elizabeth, old Betty,
her Royal Highness
Madge, it's just come out recently that she demanded a speaking part as part of the 2012 Olympic opening ceremony when she met James, aka James Bond, and he came around as part
Daniel
of the
Craig.
Whole Daniel Craig, yeah, whatever his name is, Daniel James Bond. And yeah, that was that whole
he jumps out the plane shit and
jumps out, yeah, of the plane, and like a fake Queen jumps out of the plane and they land in the thing. But yeah, so James Bond, obviously, James Fleming originally did
Ian
it.
Fleming.
I'm just putting James in there, fucking,
mate,
in
don't
him.
Let the fireworks scare you, you're fine.
But yeah, James Bond has also been continued as an ongoing thriller comic book, of which one of the lead writers is Mr. Warren Ellis.
Oh.
I did not know that.
Yeah, so it actually looks really classy. It looks like proper, like, sort of 60s good spy shit vibe.
Cool. No, like, because the James, Ian Fleming's estate, they still, like, commission all the writers to the James Bond novels.
Yeah, I think, like, a few big names have done them
Sebastian
as well.
Sebastian,
like,
Fox did one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you ready for
Stop
this?
Stop getting Bond wrong!
You ready for this?
No.
Oh my god.
Man, I'm going to touch on some nice bases here. So, the Bled performed at the 2010 Bled Fest, no relation, which is held in Michigan each year, or was actually until this year, and May of this year was the last one, alongside Strike Anywhere. Thomas Barnett, who's the singer of Strike Anywhere, was interviewed for a 2017 article about punk rock and Antifa in The Guardian. The article, I think, is titled No Fascist USA.
They will be on this podcast at some point.
Yeah.
Yep.
Things are really kicking off outside, by the way.
As soon as you mention Antifa, that's it. Like
also interviewed as part of that article with Mr. Jello Biafra and a Mr. Brace Belden.
Brace Belden, why do I know that name?
Do you know the name Brace Belden?
I know that name, I don't know
this
why.
This is so fucking interesting, right? Brace Belden was initially a member of a band called War Crime, that's Crime with a K, who are from San Francisco, alongside his bandmates Brutal Sean,
Brutal Sean,
Max Retard, and Pat.
I like Pat.
It's amazing.
It's a Pat of me
and they were, I mean, I think you could probably classify them as sort of non-PC punk, like slightly trolly punk, a bit like Anal Cunt to some extent. They had songs like Give War a Chance and Mind Kampf. But, I mean, Brace Belden is Jewish. His family are Jewish. So allegations that he was being, you know, flippant were... He was... Yeah. There you go.
Nicely like, underlined there.
Like fucking Siege of Berlin. Also, by the way, in 2016, Brace Belden announced his resignation from his job at the Willamette Weekly, where he was a music journalist, in a letter that simply said he had, quote, accepted a position outside of the country. What Brace Belden actually did was he left the USA and moved to Syria in October 2016, where he trained and then joined up with the YPG, the Kurdish Army.
Wow,
and Brace Belden became notorious.
Wow.
Infamous to some extent as this guy who left the United States, a Jewish guy who left the United States to go and fight alongside the Kurds in Syria against ISIS initially, but then also, you know, to some extent against Assad in Russia. And fascinating guy, really, really interesting guy. Apparently there's a film that's at least been provisionally approved with Jake Gyllenhaal lined up to feature in it.
That's
about
mad.
The story. He's so funny as well. Seeing his interviews, he says he kind of laughs off some of the kind of mythology or mythologizing around his history. He's like, yeah, basically, until I went to Syria, all I'd really done was wank.
But well, Brace, is that not all of any of us really do?
Really, really interesting guy. In 2017, Brace Belden was one of the top, the first three people nominated for the rectorship of Glasgow University.
Really?
Yeah, of course.
Also nominated in that year was Milo Yiannopoulos.
Oh, crossing the streams, guys.
Who, by the way... fucking absolutely threw a hissy fit people started to react. Milo Yiannopoulos became a host on InfoWars.
Didn't see that coming.
2017 maybe. I think it's about 2017, maybe 2018, before he was cancelled and booted off the internet and demonetized for sort of tacitly approving of child abuse. InfoWars, obviously the absolute shit show online channel of Alex Jones, with something like 4 million people watching every episode or tuning into every episode. Alex Jones, there's a really interesting internet meme that talks about the similarities between Alex Jones and Bill Hicks, with people even sort of comparing the two like for like, photo for photo. As a Bill Hicks fan, it's fucking way out of order, because Bill Hicks stood for so many things that are absolutely antithetical to that Alex Jones stands for. I think the problem is the parallels, things like some of the conspiracy theories, JFK, that kind of stuff. Another interesting parallel is that Alex Jones was filmed at the Waco siege, and Bill Hicks filmed himself at the Waco siege. If you actually go to Sacred Cow Productions, you can get a whole bunch of rarities of Bill Hicks, one of which includes his sort of self-documentary. I don't know what you'd call it. It's basically him filming himself, reporting on it for nobody really. And, you know, he later incorporated that into his live sets about the Sherman tanks blowing fire into the buildings and stuff like that. Also, at the Waco siege, selling bumper stickers, various sort of survivalist and kind of militia-related bumper stickers, was Timothy McVeigh.
Oh yeah, I knew that.
It's a fucking crowded event.
Yeah, I know.
Timothy, he was actually interviewed on a number of things while he was there selling those stickers. You can see the interviews online. And Timothy McVeigh, shortly after that, started travelling around the USA, especially around gun shows, selling all manner of paraphernalia, including a book called The Turner Diaries. The Turner Diaries, which you may cast your eyes over and see, I have a copy of it over there. And I had to get this copy from a sort of obscure American retailer, and I'm almost certainly on some kind of list now for ordering the Turner Diaries. It is fucking horrendous, clearly. But I mean, given the things that I research and read in my
spare time, I absolutely
wanted to fully appreciate what the Turner Diaries was about, because it's so, so central to the white supremacy movement and the militia movement in the United States. Just something I'm really fascinated in, as you can tell from my constant resort to that in the next eye. But the Turner Diaries was written by Andrew McDonald, which was a pen name of a guy called William Luther Pierce, who formed the National Alliance, I think it was a good friend of George Lincoln Rockwell, basically one of the key figures in the American white supremacy and fascist movement. A fucking horrendous, horrendous motherfucker. Timothy McVeigh, actually, when he blew up the Edward P. Murrah building in
Oklahoma,
had pages from the Turner Diary in his car when he was apprehended. But this book, The Turner Diaries, was sold by Timothy McVeigh at the gun shows, and amongst one of the many, many people that bought it was a young guy called Eric Harris. Ring a bell?
He did Columbine.
Yes. Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold were the shooters of Columbine High School.
Yeah.
Eric Harris was radicalized by a number of pieces of literature, including The Protocols of the Elders of Zion, which is a totally rubbished tract against the Jewish people from, I think it was the late 19th century. Mm-hmm. And spread by Russia.
It came out of a book of fiction, didn't it? That
it came out of a book called Biarritz. Mm. It was a chapter in the book Biarritz, a fictional story about Jews gathering in a cemetery in the middle of the night, and then the chapter was misappropriated and then turned into a sort of fake account of this journalist who then disappeared, and it was just all fucking propaganda, and it was spread by Russia via an agent in France. It was a really fascinating story as well. I've got that over there as well, as you can probably guess. Eric Harris, one of the Columbine shooters, in 1999, episode 141 of Hellblazer Comics, which features a John Constantine character, was pulled by DC as it was about a school shooting, and the Columbine High School shooting happened just shortly before the comic was due to be published, and the writer, Mr. Warren Ellis, refused to change the story. And it was then released in 2010, and he was somewhat vindicated because the treatment of the subject was very, very strong, but DC had just shat the bed.
Yeah.
Hellblazer's a great comic. Really, really good comic. A lot of great writers on it as well. Grant Morrison was on that too.
There you go.
He went truly deep there. Thanks, thank Chris. Well, okay. Go and vote for The Bled. Mm-hmm. We all say yes. Next week.
It's your shout, mate.
It's my shout. I'm going to do something not white.
Yeah.
After that nexus, are you fucking joking?
So we're going to do Billy Woods. And if you live in Glasgow, that's not the DJ Billy Woods who plays in Berkeley Suite. This is a rapper MC called Billy Woods. And he's just got a new record out, but this is from 2012, 2013, I think.
Yeah, and much like everybody that just listened to our Nexus, he's angry at white people.
Yeah. His the album we're going to be covering is called History Will Absolve Me. And I'll tell you what, he has some things to say about colonialism. And they are not nice things. They are not positive.
God. What about the roads?
Right, so how we go... So we better do a little connection. A little
Nexus, we're calling it these days.
Whatever. I got like 3 hours sleep last night, sorry. Mr. Kenny Bonella, hello there. You have chosen Alan Hansen. We have to get from Billy Woods to Alan Hansen next
week. We'll have to explain that to foreign listeners as well when we do it. So, yeah.
Great.
All right.
That was fun.
That was good. Fun, yeah. Surprisingly fun for a fairly po-faced record.
Yeah, totally.
I think that podcast was 3 times as long as the record.
Yeah, well, I need to get the hell out of here.
Get the fuck out of here.
It's your birthday and go and have dinner.
I need to get out. It's my birthday and I need to be terrorising some puppies.
Yeah.